Fruity Pebbles. You don't have to love anyone or anything, not even yourself. Fruity Pebbles. You don't have to love anyone or anything, not even yourself. You're listening to me, and my name is Hakeem Ali Bokus Alexander on the Wisdom App, Social Audio Inc., presented for World Reading Club and the Evil Elite Visionary Innovative Leaders, or the Elite Villainous Innovative Leaders. You know, what's really interesting is that there's no prerequisite to have to do anything. You don't have to love anything or anyone, not even yourself. Why is this a requirement? How could that possibly be something that you have to do? And let me explain why. Because I know for a fact that I hate people, and I have hate in my heart. And yet I still live, and still am healthy, and still can prosper and make things happen. I'm not completely full of love. It's not always there. It's probably seldom there. I mostly don't even think about loving anything, because you don't have to. However, here's what's one really interesting thing. A lot of people talk about good and evil, and yet have screwed up bodies and minds, especially their physical bodies, right? And you want to think about real evil is when you poison yourself. When you go out and eat something like Fruity Pebbles, for example, that's a bunch of garbage. Like, you know, most of the cereal that's commercially available for people is just total shit to your body. But there are people who have all kinds of spirituality, all kinds of churchiness, all kinds of things that they do, and they go around talking about being good and being loving and being all this, and yet will just poison their bodies with nonsense. Will feed their children this shit. Will feed their entire family stuff for years and years and years without actually educating themselves about what actually is really good or evil. How can you possibly function in this world and really honestly be proud of yourself or think that you have any semblance of intelligence or productivity of any kind when you don't even look at the labels of the food that you're eating? You want to know about sin? It's missing the mark. It's the Greek, right? And you know what's really missing the mark? When the things that make up the actual cells of your body are the nutrition that you put in. And you know what happens before you put nutrition in your body? You think about what you're going to put in your body. So if your dumbass thinks that you can put Fruity Pebbles inside your body and that's going to be healthy for you, that's evil. For real. I'm not joking. It's not a joke. If you don't have the wherewithal to actually take care of your physical health, the very first thing, right? Because look what happens, right? We have thoughts, then we have words, actions, behaviors, and our character, right? So you actually have to think about eating something and then think that, okay, I'm going to go eat Fruity Pebbles, or I'm going to go to Dairy Queen. And then go do that. And right away, the first thing, look, in the Bible, Jesus teaches that in the old days, it was enough for the people to follow the commandment, thou shalt not kill. But he says now, to even have hate in your heart is to commit sin, right? So on that end, because I hate most of the stupidity and the people that perpetrate it in the world, I'm a sinner according to that. But according to me, so are you if you just every day go ahead and put shit in your body, right? and don't make any decisions not to do that. You're just poisoning the hell out of yourself, and then you think that somehow that's okay? That's the real evil in the world. The real devils and demons are the companies that make this malnutrition to put into your body. But you have these doctors and pastors and all kinds of authority figures who will get up on their pulpits with their disgustingly diseased bodies from the shit that they put inside of them and have the audacity to tell you how to live when their own spirituality is corrupt as fuck because they can't even take care of their own body. The temple that their God, who made them in his image, its fucking creature ass image, and they can't even take care of themselves. And these are the people we're supposed to listen to? You gotta be fucking kidding me. Have you ever looked at the ingredients of some of this shit? And here's what the funny part about it is, right? Is that people want to propose to be so intelligent and so smart, yet will not even use a dictionary or a medical dictionary or even the internet, the Googles. They will not use the Googles to look up the ingredients in the food that they're putting in their body. Now that's stupid. I'm sitting here at Starbucks, right? And drinking this poisonous concoction, right? You know the stuff that's in some of this stuff, these ingredients here? Now, I years ago created a system called Food Awareness Subjective Testing, FAST, F-A-S-T, and another one called Food Express Awareness Subjective Testing, FEAST, which both have relations to food, right? People sometimes fast, right, which means they stop eating for a little bit, and sometimes people feast, where they eat a whole lot. So I thought it was pretty clever, because I'm a clever supervillain, aren't I, right? And so what you do is you put yourself on a baseline diet to get yourself to a baseline level of chemicals in your bloodstream. So what I did, for example, was I ate only organic foods from one source, from Whole Foods Market, and the exact same brands and the exact same amounts for 2 months straight. So that there was nothing else coming into my body except for that. You know, I can't help breathing in the gas from the cars outside and some sweaty person who rubbed up their freaking sweaty-ass medications that's oozing out of their body on the dance floor somewhere, right? You can't help all that stuff. Or some doctor who's smoking cigarettes and drips his diseased nicotine-filled... And well, it's not even the nicotine that's bad, right? It's all the other shit that's in the cigarettes. But all this gook that people are putting in their bodies. But anyway, I digress. But you see, put myself on the baseline. And then, after 2 months, 8 weeks, changed out one of the ingredients. So instead of eating the organic kale, a bag of 10-ounce kale that they have, right? And then I would replace it with some kale chips, but not organic kale chips. And then to see what would happen to my body. And sure enough, with replacing out and swapping out some of these things, there were reactions in my body. One of the worst crazy reactions I ever had was when I decided to change out my sweet snacks of the organic trail mixes I was eating and ate M&M's. And I broke out in acne in places I didn't think you could get zits. I had zits in my ear because that shit's in your bloodstream. Did you know that acne is systemic and not surface on your skin for the most part? Like, yeah, there's some dirty shit you can put on your skin and you'll get some bumps, but most of it's in your blood from the things that you eat, right? Most of it's in your bloodstream from the things that you eat. You want to talk about loving yourself? Why don't you start with thinking about what you're putting in your body? Because the thoughts are the first thing that you put in your body, right? And you know what? All this nonsense talk about how if you hate, how it's going to cause you cancer and do all this stuff is garbage. What causes you the most problems is when these things cause you tension. Do you realize that there are narcissistic, evil supervillains like me who hate things and it doesn't bother me at all? And therefore, it's not causing disease in my body. But there are people who get all caught up in all this stuff. I can't believe I hate the person, and they get so mad at themselves. You know, one of the worst perpetrations of all is this toxic positivity. Toxic positivity where here's what happens. Where you have people coming up and saying, all you got to do is be better and love yourself and love the world. And then, because if you're not feeling prosperity and if you're not happy and joyful and you're not making the money that you want, all you got to do is have more love and love more the people around you and do all this. And then, you know what's going to happen from there? Then the positivity and then the money and the stuff is going to flow into your life because you've opened channels for through the positivity and blah, blah, fucking blah. It's not true. It absolutely is not true from my experience. What am I, some kind of special outlier? I'm not special. I'm not special at all. That's not true. It's true that you can be happy and joyful and loving and be prosperous, but you can also hate the fuck out of all kinds of shit and also be prosperous. Because or else, why would Bill Gates or any of these other evil-ass motherfuckers who are like genetically engineering mosquitoes to force people to get vaccinations, and all of the other conspiracy theories you could possibly think of. How are the people at the head of Monsanto, the company that created glyphosate, who are having to pay billions of dollars to people because it's causing them leukemia? Or what about the talcum powder manufacturers? Or the people for years who've been paying out billions of dollars for mesothelioma because of asbestos, right? Don't you think they give a fuck about anybody when they created that shit? When the laboratory results came out and they still spent decades giving this stuff even though they knew they were killing people with cancer and they still made billions and billions of dollars? How much love is there for them to make that money? So what's the correlation? Please tell me. What is the correlation between love and money? It doesn't exist. There's no direct correlation between that. It's how you feel about it. If you feel guilty and anxious and depressed about that shit, that's what affects your body. That's the evil right there. It's not whether about you love or hate anything. Because if you're a cold, reptilian, narcissistic, fucking supervillain like me and you hate shit, it doesn't affect me. I sleep so well when I go to sleep. When I do. Because sometimes I don't sleep a lot. And it's not because I can't sleep. It's because I don't make time for it. Because I work at 9 in the evening until 2 in the morning. And it usually takes about an hour for the transit time in between. Like, so an hour before then I'm getting ready to go. And about 25 to 30 minutes to go there. And then an hour afterwards. So really, it's about 8 to 3. Right? So it's 7 hours that I'm basically working. Because that's a time of travel and preparation and all that. And then I get up at 5:30 in the morning, do my talks and office hours and things like that. I got my laptop and anything, this dumbass club Starbucks, right? Which I would rather not be at, but it's the only place that provides the kind of environment that I want to be in to work, right? What happened? Because they fucking destroyed all the local shops, all the mom and pop places, just like Barnes and Nobles that I'm forced to go to, has killed the vibe of all of the local bookshops that I used to love to go to, right? Amazon fucked up all the bookstore, all the stuff. Okay, I'm not even going to get into it, right? That's not what I'm talking about. But I want to address this stupid shit, right? Because even the stuff that I'm saying in the hateful, spiteful, evil way that I'm saying it does not bother me. It's not going to stop me from sleeping when I want to go get rest. It doesn't stop me from digesting my food. It doesn't make my heart go faster. It doesn't raise my blood pressure. You know what happens from that? Is when this toxic positivity, when you start telling people that they have to love and that they have to be good and that they have to do all this stuff or else let me reframe it better like this. When people are made to believe that it's because they're not good people why they're not wealthy and prosperous and healthy. And you know what that does? It sets up a cycle of guilt and inner turmoil which causes them to have more disease and more shameful feelings. Because they're like, well, I'm not rich and I've been trying to do this for all these years. I'm not successful. I don't have the house I want, the family I want, the this and that that I want. And so I must not be a good person. Why? Because they're being brainwashed so much by all these fucking idiots telling them that they have to be a better person. And therefore, that's what's going to get them to have more money and more prosperity and a better family and a prettier girlfriend and all this other stuff like that. And it's sheer and utter fucking nonsense. You don't have to. You can be. But they don't correlate. You can be as loving and fuzzy as you want to. Because that's good for people. It's probably better that you're that way. It's probably better for the world that you are that way. It's probably better that you're not like me. Right? Me being me doesn't bother me. So I'm fine. I stay healthy. I sleep well when I sleep. It's amazing how fit and healthy my body is and how my blood work is amazing. When I go to the doctor, my blood pressure, all of my vitals, all this stuff like that. But for the most part, I think my doctor's an idiot because he wants to send me to a psychiatrist to prescribe me medicine because I have prolonged grief disorder or whatever the fuck they want to call it. Shut the fuck up. So now you want to take a completely, totally physically healthy person and then put them on a medication that is going to damage my liver and kidneys and cause me to have sleep problems and cause my poop to stink even worse and all this and cause me zits and acne and gain weight and all this other shit like that. You get the fuck out of here. That is the most moronic, evil shit that I've ever heard. And he probably doesn't even know how evil it is because he's brainwashed by an evil system. And you know what? I talk about brainwashing because I have a degree in clinical hypnosis and have studied brainwashing since at least 2004, but I knew about it since 2019 because Napoleon Hill talks about it in his stupid-ass book, Think and Grow Rich, right? It's called – where he learned from Emil Cuey, right? Where they called it auto-suggestion. Day by day, in every way, I'm getting better and better. You can tell yourself that, and that can happen. But you don't have to like anybody. You don't have to love anyone or anything to get better. But you know what happens when you get better and you do better? It does better for everybody around you. And therefore, you actually do good in the world without even having to have an ounce of love for anyone, not even yourself. Think about that. You can eat healthy and exercise and help other people by teaching them self-defense or sharing a song or doing whatever, something that helps them and help the world and not even give a fuck about them. But there are people who claim to love other people and sell them a whole bunch of shit that causes people to have cognitive dissonance and think that they're not good, which is the reason why they're not making money and they're not healthy and they're not doing better and nobody likes them. Go get a hobby. Learn how to dance. Learn how to draw. Read a math book. Do something else in your mind other than trying to show off your booty. Okay? And wear Nike clothes and name brands. Do you think that makes you a better person and makes the world better? That's some evil, dumb shit right there. That has nothing to do with love or hate or anything. That's just pure evil nonsense. For you to go around doing these things thinking that that's what's going to capture a mate or make the world better somehow. That's not what does it. Actions are what do it. When you teach someone to eat better so that their physical body can function better, so that they can digest better, so that they can sleep better, so that it doesn't feel like a burden just to get up out of bed and walk around the world. That is what does good in the world. Not tricking people into thinking that they're not a good person, which is the reason why they're not earning money or why they're not healthy or why they're not happy. That is the highest form of malarkey. That is some Fruity Pebbles ass shit right there. So you go ahead and eat and feed your kids all these disease-causing cereals and things like that, and then go to church on Sunday and pray to your God who doesn't teach you anything about nutrition. And I'm not mad at you about your religion, But then don't come at me with this stuff about your spirituality and love while you're poisoning the world by contributing to the poisoning of the world by buying Fruity Pebbles and other shit like that to feed your family and voting with your dollar saying, yes, I want more Fruity Pebbles to be produced and put on the shelves next week so that it's there for other people to poison themselves and their families with. Because that's exactly what you're doing. And there's no argument that you have that's going to go against that. And then you want to say, well, I pray and everything and the spirit will heal my body. Well, then the statistics don't favor your opinion because that's not what happens. That's not the truth. But well, the physical body is permanent and it's really the spirit, the eternal spirit. Well, you can have a dumbass eternal spirit because if you live in this world with stupidity and do stupid things that poison yourself, your family, and contribute to voting with your dollar throughout, and that continues to perpetuate these things throughout the world. You think that doesn't carry over into your afterlife? You just ignored the truth that things actually poison people, that yellow number 5 and lake blue and all this other stuff that's in and tartrazine and the ingredients and the stuff like that, that you're supporting. Now, you don't have shit to say about me because I will support that every way because I hope that the morons kill themselves. That's called natural selection. So if you want to poison and kill everybody in your family with your dumb ideas and then try to fool and trick other people into thinking that they're not good enough because they don't love, they're not good enough and because that's why they don't have money and a house and all this other material bullshit that you claim that is not important because the eternal afterlife is what's important. You know what kind of dichotomy and what kind of gaslighting and what kind of cognitive dissonance that causes to people? That is creating much more harm than any good that it could possibly imagine. It's sick. So sick. If it was so true, come on, think about this. Why are the top 10 companies in the Fortune 500 the richest that make pharmaceutical drugs? That even the Encyclopedic Medical Dictionary has a term called iatrogenic illness, which means illness and disease caused directly by doctors and the medications that they properly prescribe. When has a leaf of kale ever hurt anyone that's not allergic to it? But you're not told that, right? You're not told about the life-saving frequencies that you can imbue your body with. You're not told, not by the medical mainstream, not by the richest in the world, not by the most prosperous and wealthy, not by the people you celebrate, the celebrities who people worship, who are selling you a whole load of shit. Do you know, I left this country 5 years ago and went to China. Gambling was illegal in most places. I come back here, and now you have celebrities promoting gambling, and then they dare to have these fucking disclaimers on there saying, if you have a gambling problem, what? The same old shit over and over again, just like people are prescribed psychiatric medications, anti-anxiety medicines to stop people from being depressed and anxious, right? And then they have black box warnings that say, if you take this, you might want to kill yourself. And yet, more than 50% of people in this country alone are taking that shit. And have no idea. You don't even understand most of the ingredients that are on the packages of the food that you eat. And you know how I do? Because I look it up. Now I'm the guy who got made fun of for reading the dictionary. I'm 45 years old. I can still spin through the air sideways at 540 degrees in the air at 4 feet off the ground, parallel to the floor, and do backflips. Ride my bike 20, 40 miles a day and hardly break a sweat. And I have to live in my physical body every single day. When I'm depressed and I'm anxious, it's much easier to be that way with a healthy body. If I was as fat as I was when I first got back to this country because I was drinking myself to sleep and just sitting around in my condo in China, crying myself to sleep when I could sleep with grief and just ordering takeout and laying around and not going to the gym, it was much more difficult when I was 30 pounds fatter because of that nonsense that I was doing to my body. But now, I bounce out of it like nothing. Because of what I'm putting in my body. You think that it doesn't have an effect? But yeah. Think about the truth of that reality. If it was so true that you have to be a good person and love everything in order to be prosperous and wealthy and have a good family and get all these things, just all this good stuff will come to you through the law of attraction, right? If that were true, then why are all the most evil people, through actions, right? Through actions, not words, through actions, why are the most evil people in the world prospering over everyone? Explain that, please. Give me your reasoning. And why are most of the people, really good, loving people, who love Jesus, who love Allah, who love Moses, pray every day, why are they the poor, the sickest, and the people who get sent into wars to kill other poor people? If that was the answer. Please, tell me. Can't. None of you will dare because you can't. Nobody ever has. None of the physicists, none of the doctors, none of the scientists, none of the philosophers have ever been able to challenge that because they can't. You can't. You have no reasoning. It's not logical. You want to start to study philosophy? Study mathematics. Learn about the principle of sufficient reason. Learn what inductive and deductive is. And start from there. Natural philosophy. That's what became physics. You know that Isaac Newton, in his library when he died, supposedly, it's an interesting story, right? It's an interesting piece of trivia, that his library contained more religious and spiritual texts than it did science. Because most of these people were trying to figure out the language of God. Just like Francis, what the heck is his name? The head of the Human Genome Project. I think it's Francis S. Collins. Let me look that up, right? But that's what he's a very religious, spiritual person. But he's accomplished some very interesting things about genetics. Let me see. Human Genome Project. What is it? I think that's his name. I like to remember these things somehow. Head. Francis S. Sellers Collins. Francis Collins. He wrote a book called The Language of God, by the way. Because that's what a friend of mine who I used to hang out with at the University of Miami, who then went on to MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and is now one of the main scientists that works on the Mars Science Laboratory. Her name is Arissa Hines. Arissa K. Hines. I don't know what her married name is now, but we're friends on Facebook. She is super Christian. And also a super scientist. And also super healthy physically. Because she doesn't put junk into her body. Because she doesn't rely on fake love feed herself and her family. She relies on real love, which is actually doing things that matter to yourself and other people by feeding yourself healthy things, like a healthy thought. Being angry is not an unhealthy thought. Being hateful is not an unhealthy thought. when your body is riddled with anxiety and tension and stress because you feel like they are, that is what is hate and not love to yourself. When you have been tricked over and over and over again to think that the reason why you are not happy or healthy or wealthy or all of those other catchword phrases and words that this whole toxic positivity, life coaching bullshit tells you, that's where you've been done fucked up at. That's where the problem comes from. When you have all this internal conflict and cognitive dissonance because you're struggling and struggling for years to try to make it. And you keep being told the reason is because you're not a good enough person. Because that's exactly what it amounts to. All you've got to do is love more. All you got to do is just think more positive. All you got to do, that shit, man. Do you think that teaching people how to rip their attacker's skin off as a positive thought in self-defense? Well, yes and no. Because hurting another person is not the most positive thing that you can do. But in defense of yourself, it's much better to prevail so that you don't get raped or murdered or have your family members hurt, right? So that's a plus. But and the confidence that comes with learning how to do that is a plus. But you feel better overall when you're able to understand and have that kind of confidence than not. But you see, that altogether is not a positive thought. Who in their right mind is going to tell me that violence is a positive thought? But it's something that people can be taught, and people actually feel more confident and better when they know how to inflict extreme violence in defense of themselves. Because I'm not talking about right now about cracking the planet in half with frequency vibrations, right? That's an attack on the earth and on living species and beings. I'm talking about like actual violence in self-defense. Because that's what it is. We can't pretend like it's not. Right? The enemies aren't insurgents. They're fucking people. They're not the Taliban. They're people. They're not terrorist nations. They're countries with people and families. I'm a killing machine, Uncle Sam said that he would pay for school if I enlist. All I have to do is go overseas and take out the enemies on his list. And so I pick up my sniper rifle and my flak jacket. Oh, I'm ready to ship out. And if the world needs a reminder, they're gonna get it. Cause the Corps is gonna show them what it's about. Because I'm a killing machine. A killing machine. A killing machine. All these labels that dehumanize. You know what I learned, and I have to verify if this is a fact or not, yesterday, that when a serial killer or somebody kills a prostitute, it's considered a non-human death. Because these people are considered to be less than in our society. Right? When you separate the humanness from people. It's the same exact thing. It's all trickery. It's all trickery. It's all tomfoolery. It's the same exact thing. It's a mask. It's a veil of telling somebody that, well, the reason why you're probably not doing well in this or that is because You're not having enough love for yourself. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place. And the world will be a better place for you and me. Yeah, just wait and see. Yes, but it's not that stupid idea of love. It's actual love actions. It's giving a person a hug. It's feeding somebody a warm, nutritious meal. It's giving them a blanket when they're cold. It's helping them to get supplies so that they can clean themselves and have better hygiene. It's teaching them how to fish. Not all this nonsense, vague psychological concepts. Oh, you must love. No. Put a real thought in a person's mind, please. That's not going to distract them, make them run around in circles forever and ever, doubting themselves, thinking that the reason they're not successful or not getting the things they need to support their family and do better in life is because they don't love themselves enough or they don't love the world enough. Because you're tricking them about what love actually is. Love is doing, not saying. Prove me wrong. Who's the real fucking supervillain? A bunch of assholes. Who's the real supervillains? Right? It's Monsanto. And it's all the brainwashed morons who will not get their head so far from up their buttocks that go around telling people that the reason they're not doing well in life is because they don't love other people and love themselves enough and they're not good people. Like, if only you were just a better person, you'd become the best version of yourself by loving yourself. You don't have to. You have to do love. You get up in the morning and you eat right. You take a long walk and take some deep breaths, ride your bike, drive your car, or get on the stationary bike, whatever it is. Get out in the sunlight. Do some squats, push-ups, crunches. Or if you can't, blink your eyes. Take some deep breaths, whatever it is you physically possibly can do in a healthy direction, an actual action. Drink some water instead of Pepsi. I mean, and that's the grossest, most egregious things. How dare you go around talking to anybody about self-love and then drink a Coca-Cola? Are you fucking crazy? You better shut up. I mean, I'm not telling you what to do, but shut up. I'm saying it, I'm not commanding you to do it. Right? But really? Really? Love this, love that. And they're telling everybody I'm going to drink Pepsi Zero, whatever the hell it's called, with these artificial sweeteners and shit that when they put them on rats' skin, it causes tumors. Oh, but you don't know that because you're too busy. Too busy watching the news. Rather than reading readily available scientific articles that are there for you, you want to care about your family? Why don't you look at the truth? I'm not Donald Trump, but that shit is fake news, people. Fake news. And you can very easily see it by reading actual science news that come from the scientists who are doing the research. You can actually do the research. You can do something like what I did with Food Awareness Subjective Testing FAST or Food Express Awareness Subjective Testing FEAST and test it for yourself. Eat the same clean foods if you even have the self-discipline to do so for 8 weeks straight. And then add an M&M to there and see what happens to you. See if you don't, at the very least, have a zit grow in the back of your, inside your ear canal somewhere where you're like, what the fuck? Or like you feel nauseous or have diarrhea or get constipated. You ever do that? You ever take a break from something that you haven't had for a long time and then you drink a Pepsi again for a long, like haven't done it for a long, I did that. And then your teeth feel like they're all going to fall out of your skull. Because it's the triumvirate of the worst things you can do. Sugar with carbonation is one of them, but there's something else in there. The fucking, I don't remember. I don't remember, but sugar is one of them. Probably carbonation and some other thing is all in, and the food coloring or something like that is all in those soft drinks that'll rot your teeth out of your face. But you know what? I don't even have to remember what all those ingredients are. That's the beauty of actually doing shit for yourself instead of listening to dumbasses tell you stuff all the time. Is stop drinking that stuff for a little while and then drink a Pepsi. See how your teeth feel. It feels like your gums are shrinking and your teeth are just going to fall out of your face that very second. Yeah, thank you very much. You're right. It's food coloring, dye, and acid. Thank you, Andrea. Right? It's the acid that's in it. Acid is one of them, and the sugar is the other one. And I know carbonation is one of them, but carbonated water by itself doesn't do it. It's chemistry, ladies and gentlemen. Chemistry. It's that thing that came from ancient Egypt, right? Chemistry. And chemistry, by the way, is named after the land of Egypt, the physical land of Egypt. It's Kemet. And the people are called Aturi. And there's something interesting about that King Arthur who was actually... And I'm not going to go there. Not going to mess with your Jesus right now. But for real, if you actually want to talk about love, right? Then love your body first. Because you have, that's your temple on this physical world. And if you keep poisoning it with shit, you know what's going to eventually happen? I seen it happen to my friend Daniel Johnston. There was a documentary done about him called The Devil and Daniel Johnston. This motherfucker drank Mountain Dew every single day, and that shit made him crazy. I believe it. Because I watched him go from a thin, really brilliant kid to a really fat, unhealthy psychiatric patient, and he just obsessed with drinking Mountain Dew every day. And look, I'm not. There's nothing wrong in itself with being fat. It's how did you get fat, right? Was it because you just ignored your body all the time and just ate the worst shit in the world? Or was it because you ate healthy food and went to sleep? Because you can get fat like that. There's vegan sumo wrestlers, by the way. Because the way that they do it is they develop subcutaneous fat, which is more healthy than visceral fat. They eat a whole bunch of food and they go to sleep. They get up and they train and they eat again and they go to sleep. That's how they pack on all that stuff. Now, not all of them, because not all of them follow that traditional system of doing it. But that's how you can put that on. Even the body fat that I had on when I was drinking myself to sleep with wine every single night and all that other crap that I was eating and ordering food when I was in China, most of it was subcutaneous fat. A whole lot of it was visceral fat, which I got rid of because I dropped 30 pounds of it. But that was really unhealthy. I could feel it in my organs. That's what the visceral fat is, when it starts to get around your organs and fill around your heart, and that's when you get the fatty liver and kidneys and all this stuff like that. That's the visceral part. So there's a difference of how it happens and what you're doing. And look, you want to drink a Coca-Cola every once in a while? Go ahead. But just don't think that you're doing anything good for yourself in the long run. And don't call that love. Because you know what a lot of people make the mistake of doing? A lot of people make this mistake of saying some stupid shit like this. Just live a little, Hakeem. Come on, man, you're too square. Why don't you have a drink? You know, eat some cake for your birthday. Eat this, eat that, do that. Live a little. No mother effer. That's not living. That's killing me. How do you in your right mind thinking that eating the icing on that cake that came from Food Lion is healthy? Have you seen the ingredient? How does it make you feel? I ate a cookie from 7-Eleven the other day and had a headache for 2 days straight. I'm going to do that again. I don't want to feel like that, but people do it all the time. All the time. Eat the same things all the time and wonder, why do I have this diarrhea? Why do I always have constipation? Why do I always feel so tired? Why does my back hurt? Why is this going on? Why is that? Well, stop eating shit. Try it for a little while. And I know I'm focused on this whole thing about food because it's one of the first ways that you can actually love yourself and the people around you is by actually eating healthy. Now, I'm not saying you have to be one of these, what people sometimes call a food Nazi, and go over to people's house and tell them that you're not going to eat what they're eating or I ain't going to have that because this and that and start lecturing them about their food in their house. Better get the hell on out of there then. Don't go to their house then. Right? Leave them alone. But I do know every once in a while if I go to somebody and they cook a home-cooked meal and it might not be something that I usually eat and I eat it, I don't get sick because my body is not being riddled with it every single day. And most of the time when people usually cook home-cooked meals, it's not coming replete with the garbage that you find in most of the stuff that people put in their bodies from the store that's store-bought. Right? So go to somebody's house and enjoy a meal. Look, you'll be better off eating a cake that's baked by your sister, your aunt, your grandma, or something like that than the one you buy from the store, even though they might use the Betty Crocker ingredients. Because there's something in the way that they make it, because they use some real eggs. They use something different. They didn't use some powdered eggs, some cheap substitute, this and that. And then it's like not this whole giant list of things that you need a chemical dictionary to decipher. I've seen it. I've done that. I've gone to people's house and eaten the cake that they baked and the cookies that they made. And you know what? Didn't feel bad about it. And in the case, if I ever did, then I'm not going to complain to them. I just won't eat it again. Because that's what they want to do. And they didn't ask me for no damn lecture about how to cook their food and how to live their life with their family. Right? They didn't ask me about that. But you know what I'm a little bit upset about is the plain deception that is a true evil of people going around everywhere telling people that the reason why they are not happy, healthy, and wealthy is because they're not good enough, because they don't love themselves enough. Well, then how are you telling them you love them, that they don't love themselves enough while you're slogging down a 2-liter Pepsi? And they were sitting there watching you on a video talking about loving themselves, and you're drinking that shit in front of them. What do you think they're going to do if they're looking up to you? They'd be like, oh, well, you know, if so-and-so is doing that, and well, I guess it's okay for me. And they got diabetes. And you're telling them how to be healthy and live their best life. You can't be telling somebody to live their best life slurping on that stuff. You know the lady who wrote the book called Molecules of Emotion, Candace Pert? I don't know what her problems are, right? I don't know what her issues are. She could have a thyroid problem or whatever. But I watched her on a video from What the Bleep Do We Know, like one of the side outro videos. And she is so messed up in her body. But she wrote an amazing book about peptides in the brain. But here's the crazy thing. She was drinking a Pepsi in the video when I'm watching her. I was like, what the hell is going on? But this is what happens all the time when you go to a doctor's office or to the nurses or the people who are supposed to be the health practitioners telling you this stuff, and they're doing that in front of you. Now, I'm not saying that they shouldn't do that because that's their choice. What I'm saying is that they should know better about the fact that they are an authority figure, and if they're sitting in front of you trying to tell you to change your diet and do all this stuff for your blood pressure and your blood sugar and all this and that, and they're doing that in front of you, that's sending a subconscious direct message to you that it's okay for you to do that regardless of what they're saying. So I'm saying if you want to run a better medical practice, you can tell them whatever you want to tell them that's really healthy for them, but don't do stupid shit in front of them. Because you don't have to practice what you preach. Because there's a lot of people who don't, but give a lot of really good advice. You know, my alcoholic wife-beating daddy told me not to drink alcohol or hurt women. That's good advice. But he was doing that shit. So you, and this is what people think. So that you can't take good advice from bad people. Or what is even a problem to label them bad people. It's maybe they have bad behaviors. Or even like me, sometimes things that I talk about that I don't do, but it's 99% not that way. That's for dang sure. I exercise every day. I get as much rest as I possibly can. I smile at people and hug them and love them. Actions. And I don't do dumb shit in front of them, like eating entire cakes and drinking, slogging down Pepsis and doing that stuff. When I go to 7-Eleven, I find the least of the evils that I can find in there. And I make damn sure that people don't see me putting nasty stuff in my body, especially not my clients or the people that come into my dojo to come train with me. Because I send a mixed message to people when you're trying to tell them something like that, if I were to do that, which I don't. And I'm very open about it. When I go to Lucky Cup, for example, I eat a chicken salad sandwich with cranberry on a either a croissant or a everything bagel or a bagel with cinnamon bagel with raisins, and have a matcha latte and a Dutch chocolate muffin that they have there. Never makes me sick. Never makes me feel ill. So why do you think I keep eating it? Because it doesn't make me sick. That's what subjective testing is, people. When you eat something and you feel okay eating it, and it doesn't make you sick, it doesn't bother your sleep, it doesn't mess your body up, and you still have a six-pack, in my case I'm talking about, right? You don't need to have a six-pack to be healthy, people. That's not a prerequisite. Okay, it just happens to be a result of how I have a high level of physical activity, and it's a marker of my personal health. But the real mark is how do you feel? Being honest and truthful with yourself. If a child gets fed some candy or sugar or something like that, and they feel sick, I'm like, oh, I'm so sick. I don't feel good, mom. Then stop feeding them that, because you're killing them. That shouldn't be allowed, I don't think. But then again, I'll be told, like the moron who told me that, you don't have kids, so you don't know about this and this and that, when he was meanwhile telling his 15-year-old daughter that she's a fucking moron. No, sir, you are a fucking moron. And then you wonder why, as soon as she was 18 years old, she leaves and never talked to you ever again. You're... Children and everybody that you have that look up to you or that think that they should for some blind reason just because you gave birth to them will listen to you and watch the stuff that you do. Just like we look at authority figures or people that we consider to be authority figures, and they will do what they do. Or at least that gets embedded in our subconscious and we give that a check mark that it's okay. But if you go around thinking that eating Fruity Pebbles or the like, or any of that stuff on a consistent basis, like all the time, is like sending a good message to your body and other people. All right. Well, then you deserve everything that you get. Just like I do. That's one of the very first things that I came on Wisdom talking about. That I am completely 100% responsible for everything that's happened to me, even the very worst things in my life. So if you want to talk about what real love is, it's telling yourself the truth. Because if you're going to go ahead and eat something or share something with other people, don't pretend like it's healthy and that it's okay. Know that, hey, I'm taking a piece of poison. Just the same way that when you drink alcohol, you're drinking poison. Because regardless of what anybody tries to tell you, there are no health benefits to drinking alcohol. Now, you can drink wine that has alcohol in it, but that has resveratrol and things that are good in it that are good for you. And so someone could tell you drinking a glass of wine a day is good for your health. No, it's the resveratrol, not the alcohol. The parts of the fruit in there that are good for you, not the alcohol. Do the research or come at me. and tell me why you think otherwise. Because I just told you right there what it is. That's not the whole picture. You don't get the whole picture when people put those things in the news. It has been told, doctors today have said that drinking a glass of wine a day is good for your health. The polyphenols and yeah, but what about the alcohol part? What about the part that catches on fire? Is that good for you? No, it's not. Because if it was, you wouldn't be able to kill cockroaches with it. I sprayed wine on a cockroach, and it died. You could spray wine on all kinds of things, and it will kill it because of the alcohol. Not the resveratrol, not the polyphenols, not the tannins, not all of those other phytochemicals. That's not what killed it. It dried his roachy ass up and killed it because that's what alcohol does. It's a preservative. Alcohol stops things from progressing. Formaldehyde, same thing. It's like pickle. You can preserve things with that, right? It stops the growth. Why do you think that you ever had a night of drinking and then shit yourself? Not maybe not literally in your pants, but how you feel like, oh my God, I gotta run to the bathroom. I remember I did this experiment. I was drinking and then I would stop, and all of a sudden my stomach would stop bothering me. Then drink again and eat, and I was wondering, like, why am I so hungry all the time? And why is my poop liquid? And yeah, I know it's a disgusting thought, but alcohol is a disgusting thing. So you want to get the tannins and the polyphenols and the resveratrol and all this stuff. Drink some grape juice. And I'm not talking about grape drink, y'all ghetto-ass people. I know that stuff. I grew up with that. That's not juice. Okay, it's sugar, colored sugar water. Squeeze a grape. Okay? A dark one. And you get those health benefits. Drink grape juice, which is actually not even really the best thing, but it's better than wine. It's got a lot, fruit juices have a lot of sugar in it that leaves out all the pulp and the fiber and everything else that slows down the absorption of sugar into your body and therefore makes the whole fruit better. Or put the fruit in a blender. That's even better. Put it in a blender with some water, the whole fruit, and drink that as a smoothie. You'll be better off than just squeezing the juice out of it. I'm not telling you what to do. I'm telling you how to do it. You do whatever you want. Everything's a suggestion. I'm a hypnotist, right? And I can be very hypnotic. And I know that. Because, you know, Hypnosis Motivation Institute tells us that about 25% of the people that we come into contact with are naturally going to be influenced by us. So we don't have to do anything. All we have to do is show up and I'd be like, man, I want to be like that person. But everything's a suggestion. That's what all about hypnosis is. That's why I don't sit down people in a recliner anymore, and I stopped doing it a long time ago, and putting them into a trance and then feeding them suggestions, because I realized you don't have to. And I realized also it's not one of the best things to do. In very particular situations, it works. But the way that it's practiced today is way, way too much. People should be taught what hypnosis is. I'll tell you what to look for. The three hypnotic modalities of authority, translogic paradigm and doctrine is number two, and then internal feeling is number three. And then the two laws of hypnosis are repetition and association. So go and figure it out. But I am so done with all of this. And I'm using the term that I've heard. I'm done with all of this toxic positivity. I'm trying to tell people that they can't complain, that they can't whine, and they can't bitch, and they can't have a bad day. Because I have a lot of fucking bad days, but I still get more shit done than most of you get done in a year, in one day. Try me. I dare you, because it's my experience. And I'm not putting you down. But I am going against all the people that try to freaking come at me with all this bull crap. Don't say that. Don't say this. Why are you angry? Why are you depressed? Why? Because I am. Because of morons who keep going around screwing up people's lives by telling them that they can't be better because they're not a good person, because their depression is stopping them. No, it's not. If depression was stopping me, do you think I would have a martial arts school that's successful, that have people coming in the door every day and loving what I do? Do you think that if anger was stopping me from being successful, that I wouldn't be the top man that works 7 days a week at the Central 111, one of the busiest bars that has the biggest market share in Virginia Beach, and is like the pet of the owner who's become my friend now, right? Do you think that has anything to do with success? It's not hindering it at all. If I were to sit on my ass and show up to work late every day and let in underage girls all the time, or let people in because they flash some money at me, then that's a problem. But I can be angry and depressed and do my job. I can be angry and depressed and ride my bicycle and do a backflip and stretch and do yoga. And you know what? When I do yoga, I feel a little bit better. Because that's an action. That's a thing that was done. Not some stupid thing that was said to me about, well, your depression is what's holding you back. No, it's not, buddy. Your anger is what? No, it's not. How come you can't do what I do? You claim to be happy all the time. You all positive. You all rah-rah. You're a cheerleader. So where's your shit that you say that you want to have? Where's it at? And why are these people who are the head of these companies making all this money then and have these big-ass houses, who live on these big-ass hills, but their families protected in gated communities, who are poisoning the world? Please explain that to me then. Because they're not thinking positively about anybody. They're mercenaries. That's it. They know how to earn the money by manipulating the masses, by telling you that if you take this and that and eat this and that and do this and that, like the Fraud and Death Administration, the FDA. Go here. If you want to look at the truth, one of the very few mainstream periodicals that you can read to get a lot of really good information from is called Fierce Pharma. Fierce Pharma. I've been getting their periodicals for over a decade, and I'm surprised that they are just allowed to report the things that they do, but they do it in such a logical a fashion that nobody can argue with them, because they're just reporting the truth about the financial dealings that are going on in the pharmaceutical companies and the scientific community. And they're not embellishing it with with their opinions like I do. I'm an opinionated person, so I talk shit about the science. They don't do that. They just give you the facts. So see, your grace just sent me a fucking shelf full of a picture of a shelf full of disgusting ass cookies and honey buns and fudge rounds and oh God. I got nauseous even thinking about looking at this picture. So see, what are you trying to do? Make me sick? Oh my goodness, what is this other one that you just oh geez. God, and people eat that stuff. Look, so those same packages of the stuff that you just sent me, Cecilia, that's the kind of stuff that if you ever eat that, and you know what I'm talking about, that's the stuff that sticks to your guts, and like it sticks to your teeth, and like the dough and everything like that, just like, oh, it's like Twinkies and stuff like that, right? That kind of thing. Right, it's those things that, what happened to you? All right. Yeah, it's those kind of things that make people feel sick and whatever, right? It's those things. Like, I know, I'm just looking at those packages because they all are, like, pretty much the same. It's like eating plastic food, right? I don't know what's going on right now. They don't want you to talk to me, Cecilia. You can try again. Cecilia Grace has tried twice to come up here, and I accepted it. And it just was like, nope, rejected. We reject Cecilia from talking to you in the queue. She cannot join you in this conversation. You are too ornery right now, Hakeem. No, I'm not. So yeah, the images there, like, it's the same thing as like Twinkies and Hostess and all those things, like those hoo-hoos or whatever the hell they call those things, right? That when you eat them, like, you know, like the plasticky, disgusting, gross, but you eat them. And the only way, oh man. Yeah, you know, I stopped eating Lay's potato chips a long time ago. You know what, somebody had the nerve to tell me once. I was sitting outside of a Whole Foods because one of my rituals in the morning was to go to Whole Foods and get a bag of kale and a couple of avocados and go get the bins of their nuts. I don't know what they're doing to you right now, girl, but she says you have left the queue, you refuse to join, all this other stuff like that. But they that would yeah, and it's so cheap, right? Oh yeah, that ice drink is so gross. Zero sugar, right? Zero sugar. Like that's a thing that's supposed to make me wanna get it. I would rather consume sugar than even white sugar than the stuff that's inside there. Yeah, I know. I see you're here. You're in the queue, but I kept on letting you up. Let me try something right here, real quick. I'm gonna see about this. Okay. Well, this works. All right. Well, I was able to do that. I don't know what's happening. So, I just gave it a test. Right, so anyhow, my momentum. I've repeated over and over again the same thing because that's one of the laws of hypnosis, right? Okay, I got you, Cecilia. She's going to log out and come back. The laws of hypnosis are repetition and association. And I'm repeating these things and associating them with my own life and my own facts and the tone of my voice. Because that is how to get the message to somebody. Because if somebody joined in and missed it, I said it again. The difference between good and evil are the effects that it has on you and the people around you. But it starts with you. If you continue to put things in your body, because, I mean, think about what do you have on this earth? What do you start with? It's your body. And if you're not taking care of it, look, I don't have to cite any scientific articles or anything like that for you to understand that if you don't feel good, then you don't feel good. Right? Here's what I mean. Your physical body is not as healthy as it possibly can be, then you mentally don't feel good. So if your body doesn't feel good, then your mind doesn't feel good a lot of times. Like, think about a person who's sick, right? Who has a stuffy nose and a headache or whatever, and they're acting really craggy and bitchy and sometimes insane, right? Oh, look, she's finally made it. Because when you're sick, you don't feel good. And it's hard to be nice to other people, for some of us, right? What's up, Cecilia?
Oh, my gosh, I'm just so glad you're talking about it. Because food is definitely one of my passions. And, you know, I just sent you a billion pictures of, like, every single, like, aisle in this supermarket, you know? And the sad thing is that, you know, it's not going to sit here. People are eating this on a regular basis. Yeah. And don't even question what they're putting into their bodies. Not even a question. Just take a bag of whatever and stuff it in their cars, yeah, and then stuff it in their freaking mouths. And then wonder why they have, like, you know renal cancer or something. You know what I mean? Colon cancer, whatever it is, you know? I mean, this is what we're doing to ourselves every single day. And it is our responsibility. I have a friend that eats out every single meal of his day. And I asked him if he wanted a smoothie that I made with fresh blueberries and bananas, and he said there's too much sugar in that. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? Are you kidding me? Like, I see what you're eating on a regular basis. Avocado has too much fat. I can't eat that. Are you kidding me? Yeah. And people believe this shit.
So I was about to say that I was at Whole Foods in California, on directly across the street from the Hypnosis Motivation Institute, by the way. And I would eat a 10-ounce bag of kale every day. And with two avocados and a handful of, like, nuts that I would get from their bins that you can weigh out your own. And And somebody walked by me one day. Listen to this. This is freaking insane. This is like one of the this is how crazy the world is, right? Just listen to this. They were like, "You're eating kale out of the bag? You're eating potato chips out of a bag."
Right. Oh,
what is
God.
So weird about me eating kale that's been pre-washed out of the bag?
It's really demented. Like, I know people that eat cereal for breakfast every morning. Like, as a 40 in your 40s, don't be eating. You have to know better.
Milk.
Not that you should, but yes, with milk, with whole, they think whole milk. Like, no, it's not freaking even, like, no.
And then people wonder why they have diarrhea. And then people wonder why they have diarrhea and constipation all the time from the milk. Like, I every once in a while, I came to Starbucks one day, and I usually have them put oat milk inside some of the drinks, and I don't have them put the pumps or the sugar and whatever inside of it. Hold on for a second. Mm-hmm. Sam, where you been? The school is filling up. You should come by and train. When do you have time?
Right now I'm trying to get funds together, but I work till
hold on.
Every day.
So I'm in the produce department right now of a market. There's no one here. I am here, but no one else is here. You know, yeah, but nobody else is in the produce department, and that's, you know, nutty. You know, I gotta say, in somebody in their 40s eating a bowl of cereal every morning for breakfast, and you know, even if you were taught that, even if that's how you grew up, it is your responsibility to do something differently. Like, if you're not feeling well, like Hakeem was saying, if you're not feeling well, what are you putting into your system? Actually, knowing what, like, paying attention to what comes out, pay attention to your shit, really. Pay attention to that. Like, if you're having diarrhea all the time, if you're not taking, you know, if it's hard for you to go to the bathroom, consider what you're putting into your body. Because what you're putting in is what's going to come out. And you shouldn't be sitting there for an hour trying to take a dump. Like, really. It should come out nice and smoothly. And if you're hydrating, if you're eating the right foods, it will. Also, people don't know that they're supposed to go to the bathroom on a daily basis, even a couple of times, a few times if you're lucky. I feel like if you're lucky, you know. But you're not going to the bathroom, you know, take number two once a week. People don't know this. I don't know how. That is not right. Pay attention to what comes out of your body. I mean, of course, it's going in, too, and it is totally our responsibility to teach ourselves better. I grew up on macaroni, cheese, and hot dogs. Do you think I'm eating that now? Hell no. No.
Thank you for holding it down. I just saw, you know, a friend who she's been wanting to train, but she's kind of too shy to come in. I caught her coming out of Starbucks. I'm like, yo, let's do this. Okay. These kids these days, I was like, I guess you're going to have to respond through Instagram better. So Andrea Raquel says, I worked for a hospital dealing with specialist clients. The number of patients that said they couldn't keep anything down because of their health issues and all they could eat is cheese. Or folks who are sick and drink vitamin D milk because it's all they can keep down. My show is about collective illusions today, i.e. groupthink. Yeah. So that's the thing, right? Like, people are drinking this milk every day in their coffee. And look, most people actually are not lactose intolerant. It's the molecules that are connected to the lactase and the galactose inside the products that they're eating that makes them sick and makes their body reject it, because a lot of molecules get connected to that and go in the body with it. So this is another way of physical hypnosis of your body. When you put in a molecule in your body, like the molecules that come with milk, and it's also attached to a toxin, your body starts rejecting the milk because it always has been coming in with a toxin. And therefore, even if you were to drink like raw milk that hasn't been processed, your body might reject it as an allergen because it's used to it coming in with a toxin. You've trained your body to be sick to milk. And can you believe there was a whole movement from the FDA? They were actually arresting people for making their own raw milk at home and consuming it.
I remember that.
How the fuck are you arresting people for milk? Doesn't that sound ridiculous? But it actually happens.
It happens. And you know, I mean, look at this shit that I'm looking at right now on the shelves, and people aren't being arrested for this.
Yeah, and bulldozing people's community farms.
Mm-hmm.
Like people, this stuff actually happens. I've seen it happen. They've in front of me. I watched them bulldoze homeless communities, destroy their community farms, and arrest people for raw milk.
Yes, and it's like I keep saying, it's our responsibility to teach ourselves better, even if we grew up on this like Mountain Dew or whatever. Like, you know, I was in like South Carolina or something like that when I first left New York, and you know, there were these guys that were interested in me, and they'd be drinking Mountain Dew, and I'm like, you know what? That's like, that's a no. That's an absolute no. You're drinking Mountain Dew at your age, and you don't know better. Like, it's your responsibility to teach yourself better. Like looking at these freaking fruit cups, people think they're eating fruit, you know, when they're sitting in these like freaking sugar and chemicals. Like, it's not fruit.
And it's not even the best part of sugar. Like sugar, like people, here's the thing. Here's a small lesson, everyone. Molasses is the better part of sugar because it contains 97% of the minerals and vitamins in it. That thing that they call the waste product, that brown sludge that everybody loves to hate, the molasses, that's the nutrition right there.
Yeah. Like now that I'm down this aisle where you're adding things to your water because you don't like the taste of water. What? Grow the fuck up. You don't like the taste of water. Some things you fucking do because it's good for you, like hydrating yourself. Adding this freaking little bottle of chemicals to your water because you don't like the taste of water. Get out of town. You're crazy. Like, it's just crazy, like where we've come to. And
well, it's crazy behavior. The people themselves may not be crazy or stupid or dumb.
Oh no, I didn't say that.
I know, but I'm just clarifying that for myself because I've said a lot of things earlier, and I want to continue to repeat that when I say these things, I'm not saying that the people themselves are. It's that the behaviors, the actions, and the things that are done are evil, stupid, and crazy. It's not the people themselves. Yeah.
Right. And these are the things that we were taught, we grew up on. But again, it is our responsibility to teach ourselves better. And I did have to learn this, right? There was a time that I was eating nachos and drinking beer every night. And, you know, it was like 60 pounds more than I'm comfortable with. And so I had to teach myself how to eat well and, you know, exercise. These things were not discussed in my family. Nobody talked about health or anything of this sort. So I had to teach myself. I went to the Institute for Integrative Nutrition to learn more for myself, but then I can teach other people it too. Like I know from experience that when I eat better, I feel better. When I move, I feel better. Like sitting in front of a computer like every single day, like that is not good for you. Go outside, go for a walk, like do move your body. Moving from like your seat to your couch is not freaking exercise. That is not enough. We were like freaking on the farms like all the time. And now we're just sitting in front of a computer all of the time, not even getting sunshine. Like, oof.
And I know that it's difficult, like if you are really depressed and you're not feeling well, to get motivated to go outside. But the thing is that if people take small steps, like if you can't get up and go outside, at least just get up once, take a deep breath, and then sit back down. And it eventually just build up to the behaviors to start getting up and then take a step forward and then take a step back and sit back down. And then progressive every day.
I think it was Lois that was saying that, like, maybe Lois, I'm not sure. Someone was saying, like, you know, their father was ill and just getting up from the bed, walking around the table was helpful. That was the start, you know, just walking around the kitchen table, you know, and yeah, we have to start somewhere, you know, but to keep with these habits, you know, that, I'm just like disgusted walking around the stores, you know, like I said, the produce department completely empty. No one's buying a fruit or a vegetable. Except me, you know.
The so-called father of modern hypnosis, Milton H. Erickson, who inspired John G. Kappas, who founded the Hypnosis Motivation where I went to, he suffered from post-poliomyelitis, which caused like debilitating symptom, which he couldn't walk. He was wheelchair-bound. And for some reason, this guy had the genius idea to watch the younger people in his family that were having babies, like his nieces and nephews, and observe them learning how to walk, how they progressively would get up and fall and grab on things and lean on stuff and wobble, and taught himself how to walk again. He realigned and rerouted the nerves in his body by simply watching how people how to walk from not being able to walk, by watching little new people learn how to do it. So you can progressively do something. But the fact of the matter is, and one of the whole points of this topic, if there even is one, is that the information that we're getting can be causing problems. Hey, what's up? Happy New Year. And like the things that we are doing, right? Like the what we're being taught. Like my biggest thing is this thing about like, yes, I think it's a good thing for people to love each other. It's a good thing to have love and to act in loving ways. But to just the vague psychological concept of talking about love and telling people that because they don't love enough and they're not loving enough is why they don't have money and why they don't have health and why they don't have all these things is detrimental, because it's not teaching anybody something different. It's teaching them something that is causing them to have cognitive dissonance and doubt themselves and make people feel even worse, because they're like, well, I guess that I'm not a good person, which is why I'm not healthy. I must not be a good person because I don't have the money or the health or the and all this stuff like that. The main thing right there is that we need to have better information.
Yeah, well, it's also, you know, we're not getting better information. So, you know, we can't also rely on other people to give us the better information, right? We know. So it's up to us. It's our responsibility to let others know the information, right? The truth. You know, that of course they're good enough. You're here right now. You are good enough. And you don't have to do anything differently. Right now, you are good enough. And we're taught to, yes, compare ourselves. And, you know, you're not this enough. You're not bad enough. But you are right now.
Marion Baker laughed at my little new people. Yes, he was watching Little New People. It was watching little new people learn how to be little new people, and they, and that's the thing, is that he watched something and learned how, and so everything is a suggestion, right? Because we can teach and share and give all this information now, and the best we can do is that we can't force people to do it, like locking somebody up in a 72-hour hold and then extending it to 2 weeks and so on and so forth. That's forcing people to try to put them on medication. No, give people the suggestion, because people are going to do whatever the heck they want anyway, but we can give the information and put it out there. We can educate it that way. And then so at least there's that as well as the other information. And then they can look at it and decide, I'm going to do this or that. And that's it.
Right. Because it is out there. Because if you really want to know, it is out there. Like I said, even me, you know, going to the Institute for Integrative Nutrition, I wanted to do something differently, right? So I found my way to, you know, learn differently. So the stuff is out there. You choose to go for it, though, you know, to look for it. But it is out there.
Yep, that's so the whole thing. Yeah. Well, but the problem is too, is now the fact that we have the whole authority, like the first hypnotic modality is one of the most vicious ones, because yes, I think it's a good idea to respect physicians and doctors, but it's not a good idea to just blindly respect everything that they say, especially if they're giving you bad information. And it's not even the doctors that you go to necessarily for the most part when you go to see your general practitioner or whatever, because they usually give good sound advice. But it's the problem is the fact that people don't then look at the content of what's being said. They only look at the of who is saying it, and because they look up to somebody in a white lab coat, then they just go ahead, like somebody comes up on the TV and says this and that, and they believe it when it goes completely against what they've experienced in their physical body and the things that have happened to them.
Right, and it's leaving your health up to somebody else. I mean, look, a lot of the time now, doctors are prescribing things for your blood pressure rather than saying, hey, like maybe look at your diet, you know? And we're expecting that from doctors, you know, for them to take care of our health. And it's up to us. Again, responsibility is fully up to us. I can't tell you the last time I've been to a doctor because of like an ailment, you know?
Right.
Gosh, it's because I feel good. I feel good. I feel great. Like, and it's, I know what I'm doing as to why I feel that way, you know? And I would never leave my health, you know, I mean, hey, broken bones and stuff like that. I don't know how to set those and stuff.
Well, modern medicine, but, one of the best things that they do is first aid and emergency medicine. Mm-hmm. The problem is the aftercare and treatment in which they then put you on a prescription for years and 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 years to come and say that this is the way to stay healthy. When in fact, yes, you fall down and break a bone, meditating is not going to help that to heal right away. Have that bone set and meditate while you're doing it, and that'll help if you're more relaxed and things like that, but it's a complement to it. You bust
and
your
eating
spleen
that will
open.
Help you heal faster.
Yeah, right. You bust your spleen open, or what is that? Any one of those things. I forget what I was thinking about, but it's that one. They call it, okay, so it's allopathic versus naturopathic. But there's one specific thing. Anyway, it's when there's like micro doses of things that they talk about. But that kind of stuff is not going to help in the long run. You need modern medical medicine to have a doctor stitch you up and close the wound and things like that. And then you can do the other stuff as a complement. But, you know, until we start having like super human powers where we can just heal stuff up like that, until the first person breaks the 4-minute mile and we start seeing that as possible, then, you know, we're not
going
to be able to do that.
We've been doing that, right? Though, you know, it's not like magical, right? You know, that people are probably, you know, doing it. We just don't see it. We don't hear about it. You know, people
right.
are wrapping themselves up and not going to a hospital and stuff, you know, we just don't
well, yeah,
know
I mean,
about it.
Look, I did it once. I was in Fort Lauderdale at the North Fort Lauderdale Beach, and I was drinking a beer and I thought I was cool. And so I tried to open the cap of the beer with my teeth, and one of my teeth broke out and it was just hanging on by the gum. And I was so embarrassed by this, I didn't tell anybody, but I pushed the tooth back in and I bit down on it. And for like weeks or I forget how long it was, I was holding it down, biting the tooth, keeping it in place in my mouth, to the point where now I don't even remember which tooth it was because it healed itself back together. That's not supposed to happen, is it? My teeth fused, my tooth fused itself back together in my mouth to the point where I don't even know what tooth it is anymore. So,
amazing.
That's not a miracle. That's what your body does when you let it.
Hey,
and you know what I also
yeah.
didn't do?
While
I, yeah, and you know what I didn't do while I was healing? I wasn't drinking any beers anymore because I was traumatized by the fact that trying to drink a beer in the first place as a 19-year-old kid was what got me into trouble in the first place.
Mm.
So I wasn't putting alcohol in my body, which is something that prevents the healing in the first place. But, you know, hey, look, plenty of people. Look, I know some functional, so-called functional alcoholics, right? But this is another example of that, about how people talk about how – about all this positive this. And I know people who own businesses and are multimillionaires who drink themselves so crazy, but then they get up the next day and then they just go ahead and make that money again. Now, I'm not suggesting that people do that. I'm not even suggesting that people go around having hate in their heart and being angry about everything every day. But what I am saying is that when you have these type of hangups about the stuff that you're doing, like, so for example, if you eat a cake and then feel guilty about eating it, that's worse for your health than eating the cake and feel good about it.
Right.
And enjoying it.
But I'm sorry, waking up and getting up and making money, I don't really see that as being functional, you know, because you're waking up, you're complete, like, you know, completely abusing yourself daily, but you wake up and make money, that doesn't make you functional.
It is functional because then if you didn't make it, you would not have a house to live in and all the other things that you need to continue your life. Look, people, I'm talking about functional in the world because the world is the world of material and physical things that people have to have money because it's the system that we live in order to do things. Like if you didn't have that money, that person, maybe they have a family that's supporting and that's functional for the family, even though maybe they themselves are killing themselves, but there's a function that they're serving.
Yeah, but you don't think that they're like dysfunctioning their entire family by their family having to see that, you know, I don't quite see that as functional.
I don't know if that matters. That's their choice. And not everybody has to follow what their dad or their mom does. You know, like,
I'm saying, like, you're growing. I mean, because I know too, like, you know, my family is definitely drinking, like, and that affected us a lot. So just because I think somebody, you're having complete dysfunction at home and you're getting up and making money, I just don't see that as, and that crashes at some point too. So you're functioning all for a point, right?
That's your experience, because both of my parents drank. And they did that in front of us. But my dad also went to all of my functions. He drove me to my death metal band. He supported me in everything I did. And my mom made the money to support and pay all the bills and everything in the house, even though they were doing what they're doing. And so we turned out better because they kept doing the things that they needed to do in order for our family to have a place to live and food to eat. That's what I'm talking about. Because these things are not mutually exclusive. People can be fucked up and they can still help the people that they're in charge of. So we don't have to follow those behaviors.
Definitely wasn't my experience, but I gotcha.
Yeah, it's like they. So like, and my mom, she's in a wheelchair. She's recovering. She's way overweight, but because she drank two liters of Pepsi a day. Like, so people hear me talking about this stuff and they think that I'm talking about some distant person out in the world that doesn't do. No, I saw my mom do this and destroy her health by doing that stuff like that. That's why I know it for a fact. And I watched my dad, though, who's an alcoholic, who drank all the time, but then doesn't take medicine, uses herbs, rides his bike, walks his dogs, goes everywhere, and has a physical body where he's much healthier than my mom. And he's 80 years old and still walking around doing stuff while she's in a wheelchair at 67 years old because of stuff she put in her body. That's what I'm talking about. It's like there's a difference in things that people like. But see, I'm a combination of both of them. Whereas my dad was studious and read a lot, I followed that. Whereas my mom was ambitious and worked a lot. I took those two things. I read a lot and I work a lot. And those two things together, I took the best of what they had and rejected the other things. I took what works and discarded the rest of it. And so I see that even in those kind of situations, people can still function and make things happen, even though they themselves are not doing the right thing.
Yeah, I understand. Thank you for sharing. Yeah, well, I really appreciate your talk here because, it's definitely our responsibility to, you know, not give in to, like, every single, like, you know, bright package and stuff. It's just nutty to me that we definitely need to do. And because we know better, you know, like, we can do better, but also show other people. And, of course, we can't force anyone to do anything. Right.
But it's so prevalent. Right, it's because it's so prevalent. Those are the messages that get out there the most. And so, like, kind of what you're saying, but what I'm adding to this is that we need to make those messages more prevalent, which is what I do with my writing and my publication and my posting and the things that are in that thing.
Talk,
Right, and so the thing is, like, there's a book called The Science of Getting Rich by Wallace D. Wattles in the early 1900s, and he says if you can get men of your class to get together and vote each other into positions of power, then you can start to change the influence of the things that happen in the world. And the thing that's – what's happened, though, is that the people who are in the positions of power have voted themselves into there and the ones who have the prevalent messages. And what he was basically saying is that the little people need to do that to become the big people. And if the people who are doing that get together and do it, we'll be the ones who have the dominant message. But that's just not the way it is right now. It's simply – who's getting the messages in front of people more? And that's what the one of the real issues is who's getting it. Because here's what happens. People who are living completely unhealthy lifestyles and doing all these things like that, they come into my studio, they meet me, they start talking to me, they start doing the things that I'm doing, even though the messages in the news and from their doctors and everything like that are telling them otherwise, because now they have somebody right in front of them who they can see. They're like, wow, you're really fit. Wow, your skin is really nice. Wow, da-da-da-da-da. You can move really well. You have a lot of endurance. And they can see, and so that's what they want to be like. But if all they have are messages from TV and advertisings, and they have all these happy commercials with all these sexy looking people who are probably not even eating that stuff, right? How can they be eating that stuff all the time and have the bodies and look like that unless they're getting surgeries, of course, right? And of course, there's a little movie magic. But they see that and they think that's the truth. And then they encounter me and they're like, wait a minute. How old did you say you were again?
Exactly. I get that all the time. Yeah. Because we move around a lot more than younger people now. You know?
I do. I definitely do.
I say all the time that, like, you know, there's people in their 20s, like my niece, for instance. Like, I know that I move around more than her, like physically, like I exercise more than her, like, you know, and they can't really handle it at this point because they're, whatever reason, have been sitting in front of the computers, like from little TVs, computers, you know, from little until now. And eating all the stuff, you know, all this stuff that I'm looking at right now. So anyway, I'm going to get out of here. I've been walking in circles, looking at all this beautiful packaging. So thanks.
Were you were taking those pictures like live right there? I thought you were like,
oh yeah,
down
I'm here. No. Wow. I'm here. I've just been walking in circles while we're talking.
Oh man. All right. Yeah. Well, just be
thank
be
you.
Careful. Don't touch those packages.
I won't. Bye.
All right. Bye. All right. So I'm about to sign off myself too, just because, I've been ranting a little bit, but I made my message. And sometimes when I do some things like this, for example, it's me getting a bigger picture out, drawing a big wide picture, and then eventually I'll whittle it down into something very succinct. And so then there'll be like a direct laser message of all of this. But really the whole thing, once again, is the messages that we're getting. And the one thing that I really want to counter or neutralize is this idea that everybody talks about, and the title of this talk, right? It says, you don't have to love anyone or anything, not even yourself. And it's an exaggeration because people keep going around saying that it's because you don't love yourself or you're not positive enough or this or that, why you don't have the money that you want or why you don't have the health or success or all kinds of different things. And it's just absolutely not true. Because if it was, Monsanto would not be a multi-billion dollar company. Neither would any of these things that are poisoning people and causing all these toxins in their environment. It just wouldn't be so. And it causes cognitive dissonance when people are listening to these messages, and it makes them feel like, whoa, I'm not a good person. That's the reason why I don't have money or why I'm sick or this and that. I'm living proof of that. I hate the shit out of a lot of stuff, and I get angry all the time, and I'm depressed because I have a lot of grief that I'm dealing with. But because I'm disciplined, my business, my martial arts school is successful. I make a lot of money at my other job, and I have a whole bunch of people who I influence, especially through this wisdom app, who somehow for some reason almost a thousand people are following me in just the 3 months that I've been here. So there's something to be said about that. And also because of the fact that I show the action. Right? I've been making videos about it for years, showing people exactly what I'm doing, just instead of just talking about it. Like, I have concrete, actual things that I'm doing. A lot of people want to talk about a bunch of fake stuff. There was a guy that I befriended, and he would get on to Wisdom and just start lying his ass off about he has this, he has that, da 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 da. And meanwhile, I'm like, nah, man, I don't have a car. I don't even have a place to live. But I'm actually doing things. Like, I go to my job. I own my business, and I do my online work, and I'm doing the actual work, and I tell them exactly what I'm doing. So you can see exactly what's getting done, right? And so now here I am in a completely different place because I changed it, because I'm not out there faking, talking about these vague psychological, and if I had this, and you know, and this is the way, and that's the way. No. Get, if you can, get off your ass and just do something. Even if it's just learning something and then putting it into practice. One little thing at a time. It's piece by piece, step by step, brick by brick. You don't have to do it all at once. There's some stupid saying about eating an elephant, right? You start at one part at a time. Why the hell are you trying to eat an elephant anyway? That's the dumbest thing I ever heard, right? But they make a good point. You got to start little by little. You got to do one thing and then do the next thing. And that's what I do all the time. I take the simplest, the least common denominator, the smallest part of everything that I learned that I can remember, and I just start doing it. And one of the things is I walk. I take deep breaths. You know how easy it is to just stop for a moment, take a deep breath in and out? If you do that once a day, you're breathing much better than you have for the most part of your life if you haven't done that before. So try it, right? Listen to Rodney Williams' show, Moments of Mindset. He'd do some breathing meditation in the beginning of the show. Breathe in and out. And that feels good. And eventually you want to start doing it more. Or you might want to keep poisoning yourself. The point is that I've offered you a different suggestion. And it's up to anybody what suggestions they're going to follow. And I think that it's foolish if you keep doing things that make you feel bad, as opposed to doing things that help you to feel good. And so if you're hearing a message that tells you that because you don't have a certain thing, it's because you're not good enough, if that makes you feel bad, stop listening to that bullshit. Because that's not the truth. And I've said this before, and this is one of my main messages. And this is one of the main messages that I'll end with right here. Is that even though a lot of times I deal with grief and depression, and I don't feel good about certain things, I find that when I come out of it, it's much better that I have succeeded in creating things and offering things and earning money at my job and my business and showing people how to defend themselves in my studio and coming out with these successes that I've racked up, these readings that I've done of math, science, and biology books to educate people, than if I hadn't done that. If I weren't disciplined, and I would not do those things, and then I come out of my depression and I've gotten nothing done or even have not earned the money or not helped somebody, I would feel even worse. So my point is, do your best to discipline yourself to do the things and get it done. Because when you do that and you come out of your fog, it actually will help to lift you up even higher. So you don't have to be in this whole positive vibe, this whole airy-fairy thing to do anything, to have a positive impact on the world. Sure. It's better to approach people feeling good and lighthearted and having that rub off on them, but it is not a requirement. It helps when you get out of that bad feeling to have those things, but it definitely is not something that you have to do. So fruity pebbles. Don't listen to all that nonsense. It's all fruity pebbles. You don't have to. What you have to do is get things done. Not that that's the only thing in this material. That's not the only thing that matters. Having a good, rich, and fulfilled spiritual life, it matters. It really does matter. It does matter if you can fill your heart with love and look at other people. Like in that Bible verse that says, the pure of heart shall see God. Well, look in the mirror. You're looking at it. That's why the Hindus say namaste, right? The God in me sees the God in you, or the good in me sees the good in you, or the love in me sees the love in you, right? That's what that's all about. Cecilia says, yes, our health is a pandemic right now. That's the real pandemic, right? Most of the global health. So take a look. Pure is being able to focus. Heart is your subconscious mind. And when you're pure, when you can think of a single focus, when you think of things that are actual healthy habits by taking walks, by eating healthy, by doing breathing meditation, and you can purely do that, meaning without it being filtered or disrupted by anything else, then that gets implanted in your heart, your subconscious mind, and therefore you'll be able to see good, the God in yourself and in other people.